Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2016 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Can I remind everyone to switch off mobile devices and as they may interfere with the broadcasting. Our first item today is for the committee to agree to take agenda item 3 in private, and I would ask members if they agree to that this morning. Thank you very much. And agenda item number 2 today is the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland and his annual report. And joining us at committee today are Bill Thompson, the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland, Ian Bruce, Public Appointments Manager, and Ruth Hogg, Investigations Manager for the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. And a very warm welcome to you all to committee this morning. And I'd invite Mr. Thompson to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to address you on the annual report and to answer questions that you may have on it, and for that matter, on some of the updated material, which I hope you now have before you. And you will have noted in the briefing paper that my remit covers the investigation of a range of complaints. This consumes roughly two-thirds of the resources of my office, and the balance is applied to the public appointments remit, on which there's actually a very good story to tell. I'll start with the complaints side. The vast bulk of the complaints workload involves complaints against councillors and a few complaints, albeit a growing number of complaints, against members of public bodies. Complaints about the conduct of MSPs are relatively infrequent. And even though the number received in the year covered by the report represented a significant percentage increase on previous years, most of these actually fell outside my remit. They were excluded complaints or simply inept, and therefore they were inadmissible. And just for your benefit, the average number of complaints about MSPs since 2004-05 is very nearly 24. It's 23 point something. So last year may have been a little bit of a blip in terms of numbers. Those numbers, of course, are set out in Table 11, which is on page 11 of the annual report, and Table 13, which is on the next page, page 12, shows how they were dealt with. And if, Convener, the committee is interested, I would be very happy to go into more detail of how these were dealt with. In the interest of brevity, I'll skip over that detail at the moment. During the year, I will point out that three complaints led to reports being submitted to your predecessor committee, and one complaint was still under investigation at the point where the Parliament was dissolved. In the first 6 months of the current year, the number of complaints about MSP conduct that we received was 11. And if that pattern were to continue, and obviously I have no idea what will happen to it, the total number received by the end of the year would be very near to the average that I've referred to across the last 10 years or so. I did make reference to there being a good story to tell in relation to public appointments, and very briefly, I think there are two parts to that. The first part is a significantly improved working relationship between my office, including the public appointments advisors, and the staff of the Scottish Government who are involved in the arrangement, in the management and in advising on public appointments. We have in effect a partnership approach which included, amongst other activities, Ian Bruce on my right, participating in a group set up to take forward a range of projects designed to promote and coordinate efforts to improve diversity on public boards. And I'm pleased to report a measure of success in taking forward these coordinated initiatives. The combined impact, I would suggest, has been a marked improvement in the representation of several of the underrepresented groups on public boards to which appointments are made by Scottish ministers. I would also like to emphasise that the appointment of people from underrepresented groups in society, which is a good thing, is only one part of diversity. The other is not limited to the protected characteristics set out in the Equalities Acts. And that aspect is important. It's diversity of thought and outlook based on skills, experience, knowledge, and other relevant attributes of the individuals who present themselves. I'd also like to draw attention to the fact that, and this is really important, the appointment of board members must be made on merit. That's what determines who is put forward for appointment. There is therefore, in my opinion, no room for tokenism. The proof of the pudding is in the eating, and I think you'll find that in table 25, which is on page 21 of the annual report. That shows the demographic profile of board membership at the end of 2015. And table 26, which is on the following page of the annual report, shows how that has changed over the period from 2004-2005. And I've also, I hope, made available to you an update to table 25, bringing it almost bang up to date. And that is showing continuing improvements in respect of some, but admittedly, not all of the target groups. I would just like to finish by referring to the strategic plan for the office for 2016 to 2020, which was published at the beginning of this financial year. And I have two strategic objectives, one for each side of the work. The first is an accessible complaints process with trusted outcomes. And the other is public boards, which are effective and reflective of society. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thompson. I'm going to open the session now to members who have any questions and invite Claire Hawkey to open the proceedings.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the panel for coming along this morning. And that was really interesting. Your opening statement was really interesting. It leads me very nicely into the question that I was going to ask you, which is about this, as you're saying, 2/3 of your resources is used to investigate complaints. And yet we see from the report that actually a lot of those complaints aren't progressed. So could you perhaps explain to the committee why those complaints haven't been progressed? But also perhaps what work the Commission has done in terms of publicising what they do so that you aren't in receipt of complaints that aren't appropriate for you to be investigating and therefore using up your resources.
Convener, I think I'd like to draw a distinction between complaints about the conduct of MSPs and the other complaints with which we deal. First of all, dealing with MSP complaints, obviously that's within your remit. I think that the MSP code is actually quite a lengthy document. And I'm not sure how many people who might be minded to make a complaint can reasonably be expected to understand it inside out. In fact, it's clear that some MSPs don't understand parts of it. Because of the complaints I receive, I can say that with some certainty. I don't mean that as a criticism, I just think it's quite a heavy tome. And some aspects of it are quite difficult to find. So I don't think it's all that surprising that some of the complaints I get about MSPs are not actually complaints which I can follow, because the excluded complaints are set out in Section 9 of Volume 2 of the Code, and you have to be fairly determined if you started at the beginning to read that far. And if you were looking at the index, I'm not sure it would jump out at you. My suggestion is that it's perfectly understandable that people who have an issue about the conduct of an MSP send it in to the Commissioner for Ethical Standards. But the vast bulk of, or the majority of the complaints I get are outside my remit. Some are, I think, outside the remit of anybody dealing with complaints. As you'll see, some go to the First Minister because they're complaints about a member's conduct as a minister. And that's quite a difficult distinction for some people to make as well. Some go to the presiding officer because they're complaints about conduct in the Parliament. Usually there are complaints about what's now Section 8 of Volume 2, which is liaison with an engagement with constituents. Understandably, that causes some people to become to feel the need to complain. And some are simply not competent at all. There have been complaints that, and I'm not mentioning names, a presiding officer failed to stop a First Minister making a certain statement in response to a question at FMQs. Now, that just isn't capable of being investigated as a complaint. With the other complaints, I'm sorry, if you're interested in my please observations on the other sorts of complaints about councillors, which are, as I say, the vast bulk of the complaints, we did have a position where the volume of complaints relating to the key principles and the key principles alone was quite significant. It was over a fifth of the complaints which we received. Now, these can't go forward unless there is something else to do with the detailed rules. The code says that. It's like the MSP code in that respect. It says the key principles are there for guidance alone. But I don't think that is... I don't know how to make that obvious to people. It's on my website. It's in the complaints leaflet that we issue to people about how we investigate and what we can investigate. But I think if somebody's really annoyed about what they see as dishonesty, self-serving, failure to be accountable, failure to be open, whatever it is, it's very tempting, I think, to put the complaint in under the key principles. It shows that they've actually paid attention to the code, which is good in itself. But it's not reasonable to expect them to have a full grasp of all the detailed rules. So we do actually make contact with people when a complaint comes in to establish whether there is any more to it. I'm glad to say that the volume of complaints relating only to key principles has gone on a downward trend. The other reasons why we don't pursue things is because there isn't a shred of evidence in some cases. I think it's reasonable to say that some people read a newspaper report about what a politician may have said and they're incensed about it, so they write in and make a complaint. Sometimes the newspaper report, you'll find this strange, is not accurate, and I cannot then find the so-called statement to which the complaint relates, so I can't investigate. We do actually search on social media at times for things which are allegedly said. We sometimes find them, and they're sometimes quite interesting. Other times they don't exist or they weren't said by the person. They can't be shown to have been said by the person who's complained about. I'm sorry, that's a very lengthy answer, but there are a lot of reasons. I hope that helps.
No, that does help. You raised an interesting point there about the MSP's code of conduct. Do you have an opinion on whether that should be revised, simplified?
I'm going to try and duck that one, Convener. I suspect I won't get away with it. If it could be simplified, that would be a good thing. As it happens, I've just somewhat diffidently submitted comments to the Parliamentary Commissioner for Standards at Westminster, who's revising the MP's Code of Conduct. I'm not suggesting it's a model, far from it, but I simply observe that it's drafted in a completely different way. The code itself is very short. It's 3 or 4 pages. The trouble is there are then rules which relate to it. And then there are the House rules, and there are various other things. And one of the questions I've put to the Commissioner there is, what is the hierarchy? How do you work out which of these takes priority? So whichever way you do it, there are difficulties. But it is very hard to find your way through aspects of the MSP code. And I've been working with it on and off for about 16 years now.
It might be of interest to you, Commissioner, to know that the clerks of the committee are actually looking at the code and not with a review of the content, but a review of the accessibility about it and how we can move that forward. I think Mr. Harvey wanted to come in.
Thanks very much. Just to follow up on those questions, and given that you have to look at the outpourings from social media, I think we can all just be grateful that your remit doesn't cover Mr. Trump Hopefully nobody in Scotland is giving you challenges of that nature. I was wondering whether there's ever been any sense that there's a correlation between the complaints that come in and the political cycle, either in terms of complaints being directed at incumbents during an election campaign, or complaints about new politicians, newly elected politicians, once they're in office. You know, some of that might be about political motivation for complaints rather than legitimate complaints. So those might be the kind that get dismissed. But has there been a correlation? Does that impact on your workload, the political cycle, and any connection there?
Convener, it's something I do wonder about, but I don't have a straightforward answer. In part because, certainly during my period of office, which is 2.5 years, there has not been a quiet time politically. There has always been something major going on, and of course there are more to come. I would suggest, actually, that rather than being to do with the big events like elections, a referendum, or a major campaign, it's more to do with what I think is probably best described as breakdowns in relations. Now, these are sometimes relations between political parties or people representing political parties on, in my case, largely local authorities. In some cases, the breakdowns within the groups themselves. And in other cases, there are, I'm talking about councillors, there are independents who, in some cases, are really independent and therefore not very easy to handle, if I can put it that way, and not subject to any party political discipline. In other cases, they may have been in one or other of one of the political parties and have left for whatever reason, and that obviously can lead to continuing conflict. Some complaints are very clearly political. It doesn't mean that they're inept or shouldn't be investigated. If there's a foundation in fact, then obviously there can be a legitimate complaint. If all of the political complaints were taken out of my sphere of activity, I doubt if it would remove more than a third of the total number.
But it doesn't have an impact on your workload in terms of the political cycle of your planning for knowing that this is going to be a busy year because there are big events coming up. That's not it's not a connection to that level.
I live in hope. Yes, I will not have a busy year, but that has not materialised so far.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you. Can I bring Mr. Johnson in?
So, Claire Hawking's question sort of looked at, well, why do some complaints not proceed? So I think the flip side of that question is a little bit, well, what competent complaints do you think are untapped? And you mentioned accessibility in your opening statement. What steps are you taking to improve your accessibility? And do you have a sense of the sort of the size of your untapped market, so to speak, if you forgive the business speak?
Yeah. The honest answer is I don't have a scooby, frankly, about the size of the untapped market. I'd like to think that it's quite small. It takes quite a lot of effort for people to make a serious complaint. I mean, the odd one who reads the newspaper is incensed and sends in a quick note. I'm not counting, but those who go to the trouble, as a lot of them do, of setting out what the circumstances are, why they're upset about them, that takes quite a lot of effort. It would be, well, so you've asked two questions effectively. In terms of accessibility, we keep trying to improve the form which people at the moment have to complete. We are moving to a point where that will be able to be completed online. That will make it more accessible for some people. It won't affect it won't make it more accessible for everybody. We have improved the way we deal with the complaints when they come in. As I said earlier, if they're not well expressed or they're only relating to key principles and therefore don't look as though they amount to anything, we do go back to people. We don't help them put their complaint in, but we ask questions to prompt information which would allow us to proceed. I have, I think, in human terms, an understandable reluctance to open the doors to very wide, in the simple sense that I don't currently have the resources to deal properly with the volume of complaints which we receive. Not within the budget, that's not possible. And the remit is about to be extended. There are some details in relation to MSPs and registration of certain interests. I don't think that will cause a major flood, although some of the areas it could lead us into could be quite contentious in terms of election expenses. The other imminent extension is in relation to lobbying. And I have suggested previously, in fact, I suggested very recently to the newly appointed registrar that that consideration should be given to the approach that was taken in Ireland, where they introduced the system but not the penalties immediately. So in other words, there was a sort of running in period. I think that would allow people to become familiar with it. I think it would allow honest mistakes to be picked up, and it should reduce the risk of complaints which should be dealt with by other means.
To what extent would you say it's difficult for someone who might struggle to articulate themselves in writing or indeed use online forms of communication? How easy is it someone in those circumstances to make a complaint?
Without help, it's impossible. That is the position. It's clear that some of the complaints we receive haven't come directly from the person who's complained. That doesn't matter, provided they've put their name to it. But as the law stands, they do have to be in writing. I think there's a risk that excludes some people. I think there's an even bigger risk if they didn't have to be in writing, that people would just pick up the phone or send a text or whatever it was, and we'd be inundated with snash, frankly.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Anderson, you wanted to come in a supplementary?
Thank you, convener. I have the... It's all right, don't worry. I answer to many things, convener. I knew you meant me. You talk about the potential complexities of the Code of Conduct. And do these complexities give any flavour to the whole idea of how effective and how efficient and how fair the whole process you have to manage going forward? Or does that not feature within the process?
The complexities are handled, in my experience, or so it would appear anyway, very effectively by and I'm not trying to embarrass anybody, the clerks to the committee over the years, who have given advice to members who have had quite difficult things to be advised on. So I suppose the primary responsibility lies with them and with you and other members yourselves. The complexity can make it difficult for me intellectually in sorting out whether there's a valid complaint or whether the circumstances disclose behaviour that isn't, to me, a breach. I don't have a complaint about that. I think it is reasonable in my post that I am prepared to tackle whatever comes up in that respect. There's a dilemma. Arguably, all the rules would be clearly set out in the code, but if you tried to cover every possible situation, you would have a code that's even longer than the one that exists, and that would be counterproductive.
Okay. Thank you,
Kevin. Apologies, Mr. Stewart. you mentioned in your opening statement about the degree of success you've had, particularly in women's representation on boards, which is to welcome to know, I'm sure, by everyone here today. I wondered if you're able to share any particular measures that you've taken that you feel have led to both the increase in applications from females but also the success in their appointments to boards.
Yes, Convener, I will pass to Ian Bruce once he's if he's ready to speak. But before he does, credit must be given where it's due. It's the ministers who make the appointment. So this is not a political statement. It's the government who have responded to suggestions and, if you like, advice and their own initiatives, taking their own initiatives. The political climate has put diversity up there, which is a good thing, and that has, I think, impacted on attitudes across the board. There's also a clear openness to work with my office and with the advisors who are contracted to the office to support public appointments in trying out new approaches. And I think I would like to hand over to Ian just to give you a flavour of things that do seem to be working.
Good morning, Convener, members. Thanks again for the opportunity to give evidence. It's always a privilege. I thought today, because we over the piece have given an indication of the broad steps that have to be taken in combination, because there is no magic bullet to achieve diversity, but the broad steps that have to be taken in order to achieve more diverse boards. Today, in preference, I thought I might give some illustrative examples of specific appointment rounds where diversity has been achieved, just to give you an indication of how these things work in practice. So in terms of gender diversity and looking to achieve gender balance, the example I'd like to draw on is for Visit Scotland. So there you had a board with 9 members, one of whom was a woman, and obviously they had to seek to redress underrepresentation, but obviously they are working in a context in which the visitor economy, the nature of the visitor economy in Scotland has changed significantly. So you have, as I've referred to previously, 2 targets to meet. You need to redress underrepresentation by gender, and at the same time you have specific new skill sets that the board would benefit from in order to meet the challenges that it currently faces. So how do you go about it? Well, the first thing is engagement with the appointing minister. What are your priorities for Visit Scotland over the next 3 to 4 years, which is, you know, the typical term of appointment for new members? The minister gives you a clear steer on the different types of skills that they are looking for in order for the board to be successful. And on that basis, you know, that information is provided to the panel, and they then understand, okay, we need to design a competition. But basically, we're running 4 competitions in tandem to find 4 different types of people who are going to meet the needs of the board. At the same time, you need to then take positive action. So we know we have underrepresentation by gender. So which groups do we now have to connect with in order to encourage applications from people who have those skills and who happen to be women? So that means contact with bodies with whom we are already working, the likes of Changing the Chemistry, Women on Boards, the Institute of Directors. You have an open event and you actively encourage people from those organisations, do you have these skills, to come forward. It's not exclusively for women, but they are encouraged to come forward. You design your competition. You ensure that the material that you are using is welcoming. One of the things that we have introduced over the course of the last year is our advisors now advise panels on bias mitigation techniques that they can use, and that even extends to the type of language. Believe it or not, certain terms and phrases are more attractive to men than they are to women, more off-putting to women than men. So you adapt the materials in order to ensure that they are attractive basically to everyone. You design a simple assessment process. You don't ask for too much. You don't set out a whole long list of criteria for selection, because, you know, we understand on the basis of behavioural science that may be advantageous to men. So that was done. You publicise the opportunities widely. You run your competition and basically you get the right result. And that's what happened in this case. There were five appointments made. They met the needs of the board. Four out of those five appointments happened to be women because of the additional effort that was put in. So, but that's fairly typical of the sort of activity that is now going on. And obviously it has to be bespoke in relation to each underrepresented group. And it entirely goes back to what does this board need at this point in time. So that's an example of the sort of work that's going on.
Right, that's extremely helpful. Thank you very much. I think Mr. Arthur wanted to come in at this point.
Yeah, it's actually on that very point. A reference is made on page 56 to taking steps, I suppose further steps upon which we've already built upon, particularly increasing more numbers from the under-50s and those who declare as LGBT. I wonder if you could perhaps expand upon what steps you'll be taking going forward.
Absolutely. Well, in relation to disability, which is clearly an issue for us, in fairness to the government, they did conduct a data cleanse. So, you know, we believe that the quality of the information that they now have on the current cohort of board members is more accurate than it used to be. But we did identify there was a significant issue there. They already commissioned Inclusion Scotland to take an overview of all of the public appointments activity that is going on. That in itself has led to the production of a draft report. The Commissioner mentioned our advisors earlier. It's a bit of a brain trust, so although they're all expert in recruitment and selection, some of them have particular specialisms. We've assigned one of our advisors, who's an expert in redressing underrepresentation by disability, to work with the government on basically rolling out that action plan to ensure that we are redressing underrepresentation by disability. LGB is slightly trickier. We have an initial meeting set up with SWAN, LGBT Network, for April this year, and we are going to discuss with them the perceived barriers. It's probably worth mentioning at this point, we're going to be doing much more work with public bodies themselves, because much and all as we can do things about designing a barrier-free process, the culture of the public body itself, I think, has to be welcoming to people. So it's no use just putting a positive action statement in an advert saying, you know, we welcome applications from. If people don't look at the culture of that body and think, well, you know, I could see myself fitting in there, you know, I feel I would be welcome there, then, you know, potentially that's an issue. So we are working with public bodies as well. After today's session, myself and the Commissioner are going along to an induction session for recent appointees. The Commissioner will be talking to them about standards. But one of the other things that's been very helpful this year is a breaking down of the barriers within Scottish Government. So now the public appointments team is also working with the public bodies unit, and that gives us a clear link into public bodies themselves to help them with succession planning. So it's wider than simply appointments. You mentioned younger people. We already have a link with the Scottish Youth Parliament, so we are going to be talking to them largely on an educational basis about, you know, the potential for them to consider positions in public life, not necessarily now. We have a seminar lined up with this is via the National Union of Students, and that's to do with officers who are assigned to colleges with a view to them, so they have some board experience at that level with a view to them perhaps considering taking on roles. We're also speaking to employers, so the likes of the Royal Bank of Scotland, Standard Life, about the possibility of being released because time commitment is an issue, so seeing that as a development opportunity. We have irons in a great many fires. We do understand that, you know, we have a lot of work still to do, and we do have another, we did speak about our action plan the last time, another much more detailed action plan, because we've ticked a few of the boxes, but we've got many, many more things to do, and, you know, I'm sure we'd be very happy to share that with the committee once that's completed, if that would felt to be helpful.
Well, I'm sure my colleagues would be delighted to receive that information. Sure. Ready. And I thank you for that comprehensive answer. Your voice is certainly holding up very well. But just to turn to a potentially related matter, but the Scottish ministers can approach the Commissioner to request that certain provisions of the Code can be set aside. Now, of 40 such requests, 17 were granted. I wonder if the Commissioner can explain what types of circumstances led him to agree to those requests.
Yes, Convener, I can. So this is going to sound slightly dry, but this is the detail of it. So on five occasions, I was asked to agree changes to panel composition. For example, in one case that involved a newly appointed chair becoming involved at an early stage, not at the very beginning of the process. The code of practice, by the way, requires the panel to be set and to remain so that you don't have three people interviewing five candidates one day and a different group of people interviewing candidates another day, so that there has to be consistency. In a number of cases, the term of appointment of a board member has been extended beyond the normal 8-year maximum. The code of practice sets an 8-year maximum. That's been agreed with ministers and with the Parliament, actually. It was extended on three occasions, and two of these were health boards to provide continuity at the time when the integrated joint boards were being were starting to get up and running. I'm bound to say I haven't agreed to all requests that have come in of that nature, but three were agreed. In four cases, the field was so strong when the appointment round was run that the minister, instead of appointing, say, two people, wanted to appoint three because there were such good candidates. So that has happened in four cases. On two occasions, we've allowed changes to the application and assessment method. One of these was because of the online system failing at a critical point, the government's application process. And it ended up with people putting in different types of applications at different points. In one case, there was an emergency appointment made much quicker than the normal process because a body chair had to leave unexpectedly early. This obviously can happen. Even body chairs are human. And on two other occasions where vacancies occurred unexpectedly, I've agreed that the minister can go back to the list of people who could have been appointed at a recent appointment round but were not appointed and offer the position to one of those people who had already been through the recruitment process and identified as suitable for appointment. I'm sorry, that's not wildly interesting, but that's the reality of it.
No, I appreciate it. I think it's very useful to actually capture that and share that information with the committee. But just a final point I wanted to raise. On a strategy that's outlined as public boards which are effective and reflective of society. And in your opening statement, Commissioner, you stated that diversity of thought, characteristics and outlook are also important and that there's no room for tokenism. I just wonder, in terms of diversity of thought, characteristics and outlook, how you can capture that information.
There are ways. I think probably Ian Bruce is slightly more expert on that than I am. It won't always work. And I'm bound to say there are a number of challenges in increasing diversity of board membership, not least of which is handling it when people are appointed. But anyway, on how they're identified, I'll hand over to you.
One of the things that's been particularly interesting to me is the fact that ministers have taken the opportunity to look for new things. So I mentioned Visit Scotland, but one of the examples that I've used with the people I'm working with in Scottish Government on some of our outreach activity, I think is a very good example. The chair of Sport Scotland, who was appointed this year. So the minister in that case said, well, my priority is someone who, yeah, is passionate about sport, but equally someone who looks to achieve equality and social change through sport. And that means the type of person that you're looking for is very different to what one might have in one's mind, you know, as the traditional board member. And the person ultimately appointed to that role was the co-founder of The Big Issue in Scotland and the founder of the Homeless World Cup. And I think all you need to do is think about proliferating that for all types of appointment. We are now engaged along with the government, and I feel duty bound to name check Evie McLaren and Kirsty Walker as I did the last time from the public appointments team, because we are very fortunate to have that continuity. So, you know, we are working together now in partnership with them and the public bodies unit on a new project to try and capture what is perhaps an ineffable thing. It's very easy to count the numbers, you know, how many women are on boards, how many people are disabled. But some of these other characteristics are a bit more ineffable. There's lots of evidence from the private sector that difference makes a difference to boards' effectiveness, the bottom line. You know, you can look at profit and loss and what have you. In the public sector, nothing equivalent has been done. So we are embarking on a groundbreaking project in Scotland, which is, along with boards themselves, having a look at the difference that difference is making to their governance. So what are the different behaviours that are going on boards as a result of the different perspectives that you now have around the table? Is the chair harnessing those perspectives effectively? And what difference does that make to the quality of the debate that we're having, whether or not proposals are being properly scrutinised, whether or not executives are being better supported because of the range of advice that's available to them, and so on and so forth. So it's a four-year project, and we hope to be able to report to the committee in due course about the difference that diversity is making to our boards in relation to those. It's difficult, but... Yeah.
Well, I look forward to hearing. Thank you very much.
I just want to be clear, we're looking at the impact on governance. That's what we're concerned with the research project.
I'm sure those updates would be very welcome going forward. Mr Harvey, you wanted to come in?
Thanks. Just to follow up the questions about diversity, on two of the characteristics, disability and age, I wonder if there's any attempt to get beyond a sort of binary understanding of whether somebody is disabled or not disabled, or you know, under 50 or over 50, because, you know, if we end up, the age one is particularly underrepresented, but if we end up recruiting lots of able-bodied white men in their mid 40s, we haven't necessarily had a huge impact on diversity. And similarly with disability, we might see an increase in the number of people who are disabled, but without overcoming the barriers that still exist to people whose disability requires a more significant kind of adaptation to enable them to take part. So I just wonder if there's scope for more of a kind of spectrum understanding rather than a binary one.
These are very fair points. The figures which we produce are given to us by the government, and Ian did make reference earlier to a data cleanse in terms of disability. The government are in turn dependent on what board members are prepared to disclose, which means that the question that you have quite properly asked is difficult to give a reassurance on in terms of the statistics, because it's dependent on what people are prepared to disclose. But I think, going back to what I said at the very beginning in my introductory remarks, we are looking at diversity in its broadest sense, not binary, as you put it. And I entirely agree, either that you could have a board entirely made up of people who apparently have completely different characteristics but all think the same way. Or you could have a board of people who all look the same but actually think quite differently. So we're now getting into, and the research project which Ian mentioned is our attempt to dig down into that. And it is quite a difficult area, but we're optimistic that we'll be able to at least get some information to start with, and that will, I think, open a conversation and encourage people to think differently about difference. Sorry.
And even on a characteristic that many people understand in binary terms like gender, how do we take account at the moment of people with a non-binary gender identity? Is that recorded at all?
I think the short answer to that is no.
Okay. That's perhaps another interesting one to think about for the future then.
Thank you very much. Mr. Johnson?
So obviously this is part of pre-budget scrutiny, so I'm just wanting to ask a few questions about your budget. And obviously the biggest portion of your £853,000 budget is staff. So I was just really wanting to ask a few questions about staff composition and so on. So I'd just like to start with your workload, first and foremost. I mean, last year you received 245 complaints, which were form 132 cases, which was up from last year but down from 2 years ago. So I mean, would it be fair to say that your workload is relatively consistent? I mean, is it sort of trending around a kind of a stable mean?
Yes. In terms of numbers, yes, it is. But there are problems if the assessment is made purely on the numbers. There is very significant variation between the complexity involved in complaints. Some of them probably only consume several hundred pounds worth of resource within my office. Others may consume tens of thousands of pounds worth of resource. There is a trend at the moment, although the numbers, yes, you're absolutely right, in statistical terms, you could find a mean. It's around 130 cases a year. There are significant variations from one year to another, but it does come back roughly to that mean. And as I mentioned, the number of MSP complaints over the years is very roughly 24, 30 last year, which is statistically a big shift, but actually not a big number. But the complexity seems to be going up. And that is in part down to, this is a question of being the victim of your own success, in part down to reducing the number of complaints which, if you like, are easily dismissed because they're not properly formed or they're not competent. Therefore, those which are left, there's a larger percentage which have to be gone into in more detail. In part, it's down to a tendency, in some cases, to involve, for those against whom complaints are made, to involve representatives, usually legal representatives. I'm a lawyer, by the way, but lawyers complicate things. But that's true. It's the way it happens. And then there is, I think, particularly among some of the politically motivated complaints, I think there's a growing tendency for people to want to throw as much into it as possible. And we're not unusual as a complaints body in this respect, but we get hundreds of pages of stuff from people sometimes, and no matter how hard I try to ask them to tell me which bits are relevant, it doesn't always work. And then you have people who find something else 3 weeks later, and then you're just about ready to finish it 3 months later, something else comes in, and they're determined that they're going to get whoever this is, or make you get them, in my case, me. And then the further complication is that after I've made a decision, if it goes as a report to the Standards Commission, they almost always hold a hearing. With an MSP complaint comes to this committee. At a hearing, I present my findings, or I'm represented by one of the people in the office. If there is no breach, in my opinion, then there is no right of appeal. But quite a number of people don't accept that. And because of freedom of information, which in principle I support, I think it's a good thing, they can ask for a great deal. Now, if there have been hundreds of pages of documents looked at, they can ask for a lot of information, and then they can come back with almost endless comments on little bits here and there. That consumes, possibly wastes, quite a lot of resource.
So in the last year, you've employed two new members of staff. Is that correct?
Two new investigating officers, yes, on a part.
And what were...
I'm sorry. Three new investigating officers.
Three new investigators. So that, yep. And your total staff is 17, is that? That's correct?
Yes.
So what's been the sort of the driver to increase that? I mean, I note that's driven your median salary cost from 39,000 to 47,000 a year.
The three new investigating officers were, if you like, replacements for two who had retired, and one extra. They have actually been employed at a lower salary scale than those who were employed before, because those who were employed before have protected terms and conditions from previous iterations of the office, which I now hold. This is the third, and the third version of it in about as many years. There were two separate commissioners, then there was a commission, and now there's one commissioner. So there have been complications there. We are also in the course of this year preparing to tender for a complaints management system. Although we have one, it's very old, and it was actually developed by a member of staff in the office, and it is in danger of falling over because it's not supported by on the platform on which it was developed many years ago. That has put quite a lot of strain. 17 sounds like a large number of people, but it's not, because a lot of them work part-time. The investigating officers are home-based, with one exception. So they're not actually in the office at all. So we have one, if you like, supernumerary member of staff to ease the administrative burden throughout the year. The other fact is that staff salaries, which are, they follow the corporate body's scales, they have gone up by small percentages year on year.
Your total salary cost hasn't gone up by a small percentage. It's gone up by over £50,000.
Yeah, and some of that is down to the amount of time that's spent on investigations, and that I cannot readily control.
So, I mean, can I? And so, just coming back to the workload point, you're dealing with about 2 to 3 full investigations on average per month, with a total of 245 complaints. So, just per staff member, you're 1 or 2 full investigations a month, dealing with 2 or 3 complaints.
No, in practice,
per working day,
the number. Well, investigating officers are generally employed 1.5 days a week. So that, I'm afraid, will skew your calculations, but the number of current investigations which each investigating officer is dealing with varies during the year. At one point it was averaging at 10 each. It's currently down at between 4 and 5, I think, on average. Now, so it's not easy to appreciate where you're coming from.
I'm not
trying to be difficult, but it's just not as simple as that, I'm afraid.
No, but at the same time, I'm just trying to understand your staff costs, because it is that, that you know, the fundamental is the biggest line item on your P&L.
Of course. Yes, always will be.
And if I'm just sort of drawing the very crude comparison, an MP's, as an MSP's office, we get around 80,000 to spend on our staff. In terms of the total number of kind of constituent contacts would be several times the 245 figure, and indeed the number of cases correspondingly high. I'm just sort of, and our median staff cost in an MSP's office would be around 25 to 30,000. I'm just trying to get an understanding of why you need to employ people on a considerably higher salary to do what I think, in terms of the you know, dealing with complainants and so on, ostensibly not substantially different subject, you know, or type of work. I'm just really just trying to understand kind of what the driver for that high salary, median salary is.
I think it would be a good idea to have a bit more information about the comparison you're drawing between the sort of work done in any of your constituency offices and the sort of work done by an investigating officer.
So your highest paid member of staff is paid more than an MSP, though, is that correct? So over £62,000 a year.
That is a protected salary scale for somebody who works not a full week, but yes, if that individual were employed full time, yes, they would be paid more than an MSP.
So is it the preparation of the reports then, which is taking the work? I'm just trying to, in terms of pure volumes, I don't think it's necessarily about the volume of communication, or is it? I mean, what I'm just trying to understand what the driver of the work is and the requirement for the higher salary.
Well, we've talked this morning about the complexity of the codes. My office deals with a very large number of codes because there's the MSP code, there's the councillor's code, and then there are the individual public bodies' codes. They're not all on the same terms. There is complexity in the issues, I think Mr. Stewart asked me about this, which the investigating officers, who are the highest paid staff, have to be able to assess. They are involved in gathering information, which sounds simple, but it's not. They're assessing sometimes complex information, sometimes apparently simple information. They're interviewing people who may have a reason not simply to come out with all of the information that I need. Some of these people are in positions of authority where they are not used to being challenged. Writing up the results of investigation is actually quite a demanding exercise. I would be very surprised if many of your constituency staff would be expected, I'm not saying they wouldn't be capable, but I'd be very surprised if they were expected to write the same sort of reports. They are my reports, I have to say, because I am answerable for everything that's in them. And I don't just sign them off. It's not like that at all. I do question them, discuss them, change them. I'm not sure if that gives you the answer. It's the best I can do off the top of my head.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson. I think Mr. Stewart... Good this all morning. Mr. Stewart's got a question for you.
Thank you, convener. Can I just follow on from that, Mr. Thompson? The cost of an investigation varies depending on the complexity of that investigation. And what I see from the report is the majority of your investigations are relatively low cost in trying to do it. But at what stage would you stop an investigation, or would you stop an investigation if it was continuing to move in a direction that was incurring more and more costs for the organisation?
At the moment, I have no authority to put a cost limit. I do have discretion as to whether or not I investigate, and I have discretion as to how I investigate. However, I'm governed by administrative law, which means my decisions have to be, in simple terms, reasonable. And I think if I had started an investigation, particularly if it looked as though it was going to uncover evidence of a breach, and I were then to stop it because we'd already spent up to the limit. Now, that's not what you're putting to me, I appreciate that, but I'm trying to think how we would be able to manage cost increases in a way which was competent. I haven't got an answer to that. I appreciate the point you're making. I think about it quite a lot. I have endeavoured to come up with ways of limiting the range of investigations which we do conduct. I'm afraid I didn't get much response when I tried that. And it is tricky, because how do you decide, and at what point do you decide this is not important? It's important to the person who's put it in. If there is no evidence, I will stop it. And I then spend, some cases, 2 years or longer to-ing and fro-ing with the person who thinks I should have spoken to so-and-so, whoever heard such-and-such or whatever. That then racks up cost, which I can't properly allocate against a current investigation. And that is part of the reason for the cost, I'm afraid. So I do stop things, but there's consequences.
And if the complainant doesn't like the answer that you give, that can continue that whole process?
We're always trying to improve. I think it's only fair that I answer people's questions. If they are not clear about what I have decided or why I've decided it, I think it is only fair that I try and explain that. It becomes difficult if we've been doing that for months and the questioning is still going on. We do have a policy on vexatious complainants, but it's very difficult in a public post simply to stop communicating with somebody, particularly if they're clever enough to come back with a different question, which, of course, people are.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Commissioner, you mentioned a couple of pieces of legislation that are likely to be of interest to this committee going forward. That's the Lobbying Scotland Act 2016 and the Interests of Members of the Scottish Parliament Act 2016. I wonder if you can give us any indication of how these acts might impact on your workload, the working practices and the resource constraints you've spoken about.
I'm not expecting the changes to members' interest legislation to throw up much in the way of additional work for the office, but I think anything that does come through could be quite difficult because of the complexities which you'll be aware of in terms of the way the legislation has had to be framed. Lobbying, I've given evidence in the past to the effect that I'm assuming there will be very few complaints which I have to investigate. That assumption is founded on hope rather than evidence. I don't have any evidence, obviously. And it's one reason why I have suggested today and previously that serious thought should be given to introducing the whole regime in stages, giving it time to bed in before it, if you like, kicks off in anger with complaints. Well, there are criminal offences here, which I think people could stumble into quite innocently through lack of appreciation. There will, of course, be education, there'll be information. People are busy, they don't always pick that up, I'm afraid, or they may not realise.
Okay. Thank you very much. If that's all the questions from the members, can I thank you very much for your contributions today and you and your colleagues today. And on that note, we'll be moving into private session.
Thank you.
Thank you.